Hi, I'm Mark Hobie, producing artistic director at Paper Mill Playhouse. All of us here at Paper Mill hope that you and your loved ones are safe and healthy during this time. While our theater is physically closed right now, we wanted to find a way to bring a theatrical experience right to you, to bring theater into your lives, into your homes. And so we've dug into our vaults and found these Humanities symposiums from the past. We'll be streaming them live each Thursday night at 7 p.m. Just tune in to our Paper Mill Facebook page and have a theatrical experience right from your couch. Hope to see you here each week.
All right, so it's time to begin. I would like, first of all, to introduce to you our musical director and our conductor of Children of Eden, who will be at the piano this evening, Danny Kosarin. Tonight, we are going to meet Stephen Schwartz, who is one of the great musical theater composers. Before he comes out here, though, we'd like to give you a taste of some of his songs from one of the most successful musicals of all time. We're going to start with a medley from the musical Godspell. And to start out, please welcome Miss Stephanie Mills.
Love thee more dearly, follow thee more nearly, day by day, day by day.
When you feel sad or under a curse, your life is bad, your prospects are worse, your wife is sighing, crying, and your olive tree is dying. Temples are graying and teeth are decaying and bracket is weighing your purse. Is everybody happy? Tough crowd. Your mood and your robe are both the deep blue. You bet that Job had nothing on you. I don't forget that when you get to heaven, you'll be blessed. Yes, it's all for the best. Take it, Vince.
Some men are born to leave at ease, doing what they please, richer than the bees are in honey. Never growing old, never feeling cold, pulling pots of gold from thin air. The best in every town, best at shaking down, best at making mountains of money. They can't take it with them, but what do they care? They get the center of the meat, cushions on the seat, houses on the street where it's sunny. Winter's at the sea, winter's warm and free, all of this and we get the rest. But who is the land for, the sun and the sand for? You guessed, it's all for the best.
I say, I say, I say, I say, I say. I say, I say, I say, I say, I say, what? What did the Pharaoh do when it got dark?
I don't know, what did the Pharaoh do when it got dark?
He turned on the Israelites. The Israelites. See, they thought it was funny. I say, I say, I say, I say, I say.
I say, I say, I say, what?
What's the phone number to the Garden of Eden?
I don't know. What's the phone number to the Garden of Eden?
Adam 812. See, these are the jokes, folks. Don't get better. I say, I say, I say, I say, I say, I say.
I say, I say, I say, I say, what?
What did Noah get when he crossed an elephant with a rhinoceros?
I don't know. What did Noah get when he crossed an elephant with a rhinoceros?
Easy for you to say.
Elefrino!
Elefrino? Elephant rhinoceros.
Some men are born to live at ease, doing what they please, richer than the bees are in honey. Never growing old, never feeling gold, pulling cups of gold from thin air.
Love
best in every town, best at breaking down, best at shaking down.
Mamma mia,
you can't take it with them, but what do they care? They get the center of the meat, cushions on the seat, houses on the street, where it's sunny.
Never growing old,
you get the rest. But who is the land for, the sun and the sand for? You guess,
yes,
it's all for the best. Yes, it's all for the...
All your wrongs will be redressed.
Yes, it's all for the...
Someone's got to be oppressed.
Yes, it's all for the best.
Who's that?
Hey, who's that? They're playing my song, wait.
Woo.
Turn back. Forswear thy foolish ways. Old now is earth, and none may counterweight. La da 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 da. Yet thou, her child, whose head is crowned with flame, still will not hear thine inner God proclaim. Let me find some of the men here. Turn back, old man. You don't mind if I sit here for a while, do you? Turn back, old man. Oh, where are the men? Turn back, old man. How am I doing, cutie? For since we're thy foolish ways.
At thy feet we fall, prodigals confessing all.
We beseech thee, hear us.
We thy call have disobeyed, into paths of sin have strayed, and repentance has delayed.
We beseech thee, hear us.
Come sing about love that caused us first to be. Come sing about love that made the stone and tree. Come sing about love that draws us lovingly.
We beseech thee, hear us.
Grant us hope from a tear to rise, and to strain with eager eyes towards a promise heavenly Christ.
We beseech thee, hear us.
Come sing about love,
love
that caused us first to be. Come sing about love,
love
that made the strong and tree. Come sing about love,
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 love, love. We beseech thee, hear us.
All good gifts around us are sent from heaven.
Thank you.
These are all members of our cast of Children of Eden. And, you know, Children of Eden is the other end of the spectrum for Stephen Schwartz. Between Godspell and Children of Eden is the story we're going to tell you tonight. And here he is to tell you that story. Please welcome Mr. Stephen Schwartz. Stephen, we'll talk a little bit, and then I want you to play something for us. Godspell was such a phenomenon, and I think everybody would like to know the story. Did you actually write this when you were in school, or how did it happen?
The show was actually done in school, but not by me.
Uh-huh.
There was a fellow named John Michael Teblak,
right,
who was a directing major at Carnegie Mellon in Pittsburgh, which is also where I went to school. And he was looking for a project to direct, and John Michael was also interested in the Episcopal ministry. And so he was trying to figure out a way to do both at the same time. He went to church during Easter, I think it was, at the height of the Vietnam War when there was a lot of intergenerational conflict, etc. And he was taken by the sort of bitterness within the congregation itself and the sort of lack of high spirits and joy at what he thought should be a joyous holiday. And that gave him the idea to do Godspell, which was to reapproach the Jesus story and specifically the Gospels from a position of joy and coming together. And that led to
Godspell. So then when did you come into the picture?
So that was done at Carnegie Mellon, and I actually had graduated the year before, and I was in New York hawking my wares. And they then Godspell moved to a little production at the Café La Mama off Broadway. And meanwhile, and a couple of producers, Edgar Lansbury and Joe Baru, came to see it there. And meanwhile, they had heard the score to Pippin, which I did do at school, and I had brought too. So that's how this all worked. And I had brought Pippin to them, and they were not interested in doing Pippin. But then they called me when they saw Godspell. At the time I was like, wow, they called me. I assume that actually what happened was they called every composer in New York. And then when everyone said no, they thought, well, what about that kid, you know? They called me and I went in to see it and they said, do you want to do this? And I said, sure, it's great. I'd be delighted to do it. And they basically wanted me to put a new score into the show. We actually kept one of the songs that was in the show at Café La Mama, which was the song By My Side, which had been written by cast members. And I said, great. And they said, fine, we go into rehearsal in 5 weeks, go.
Write the songs.
Write the songs. And I was so young and stupid, I didn't know you couldn't do it. So I said, all right, and I did. And that was 5 weeks later, there we were.
Incredible.
I know, it
and
was
your whole
weird.
Life changed.
My whole life changed, yeah, it was very strange.
Now, you had your success with the off-Broadway production at the Promenade Theater of Godspell.
Yeah.
And then at the same time, or just before that, or after that, came Butterflies Are Free?
Actually, Butterflies Are Free was 2 years before.
Uh-huh.
Right when I had come to New York, I had gotten an agent, and the very first thing that happened was that she knew about this play, Butterflies Are Free, that was being done, and it's a story about a blind young man who has aspirations of being a folk singer, and within the play, he wrote a song. And so they wanted a song that sounded like he wrote it, and she said, why did you submit something? And so I did, and they took it, and I made the fabulous sum of $25 a week for doing it.
But it ran a long time.
It did. Those $25 mounted up. Yeah. It must have been, $250 by the time it was done.
Exactly, but then you also got to do the motion picture.
I know, then it was in the movie.
So
no, I don't mean to disparage it. It was great, and I was
thrilled. But would you play that song for us, since it was the first Stephen Schwartz song?
Don't hold this against me, because I was 21 when I wrote it.
21. Okay?
Remember, it's supposed to be a blind composer.
So close your eyes.
All right, close your eyes. Okay. If I remember it.
Thank you.
Stay? Yeah. Sit. Stay.
So then came Godspell.
There it was.
The Grammy Award-winning cast album, right?
Yep.
And then, as that was running off-Broadway, then what happened? You got approached to now do Pippin?
Well, the first thing that happened in between... Well, what happened in between that was the Bernstein Mass.
Right.
That,
Kennedy Center.
Yeah, Leonard Bernstein. It was another thing which was impossible to do. Bernstein, who had been commissioned to do a work for the opening of the Kennedy Center, and the Kennedy Center was opening that September, and he had nothing. He had little dribs and drabs of ideas and pieces, and he knew he wanted to do something about the Catholic Mass. And he was brought to see Godspell, and talked to me afterwards, and we had a meeting, and I sort of had an idea of how to begin to put these pieces together, and suddenly it was like, okay, you're doing it, come in, help me do this. We opened in September. Again, I was so stupid, you know, I didn't know you couldn't do it. So that happened, but actually prior to the opening of Godspell, my agent had brought me to play the score for Pippin for Stuart Ostro, who was a well-known Broadway producer at the time. He had done 1776 recently. And he optioned the show, and I think by the time Godspell opened, in fact, I know by the time Godspell opened, that was
already
ongoing.
Works.
I think, uh-huh. I think we already had begun working with Bob Fosse, because it opened like a year later. It opened in 72.
It's incredible. Just for the chronology, then we're going to go back and talk about Pippin, and then very, very shortly after that, Magic Show happened.
Magic Show was 2 years later.
2 years later.
Yeah.
So you had three shows running at once.
That's correct.
All ran over 1,900 performances each.
The Magic Show was about that, yeah, 1800.
But they ran a lot.
They ran a long
three
time.
Three huge hits,
they ran
and
a
you
long
were
time.
About 25 years old at this point?
Yeah, I think so, yeah. 24, 25.
The
yeah.
true wunderkind of the theater.
I guess. Everyone hated me, and now you know why.
So what was it like working with Bob Fosse?
Well, it was challenging. I think it's something that I would handle much, much better now, being older and knowing how to collaborate with people. I mean, Bob was an extremely forceful personality. He had very, very strong opinions, and he also was used to coming in and essentially taking work and just making it his own and doing whatever he wanted with it. And I was just coming off Godspell, where I basically got to do exactly what I wanted. So there were some clashes, and it was quite a difficult experience. You know, I sort of regret that my work with Bob Fosse, who was one of the great theater geniuses, occurred that early in my career. I think I would handle it better, and frankly, have had a much better time of it. But ultimately, the show came out well. So mm-hmm. I guess in mm-hmm. the end, that's what matters.
Why did you decide to do Pippin? It's the story of young Charlemagne.
Right.
And
well,
it's
I started
such an
it
odd
at school.
Choice for musical, and it's a very unusual musical.
Well, what happened was that I began it as I said at Carnegie. When I was at Carnegie, they had an organization called Scotch and Soda, which did an original musical every year. It was not allied with the drama department. And I wrote the show the 4 years that I was there. And after my second year, I was looking for what to do my junior year. And a friend of mine had taken a history course, and he found this little story about Charlemagne's son, Pippin, who had led a rebellion against him. And at that time, there was a show playing in New York called The Lion in Winter, or maybe the movie. Maybe it was the movie. The movie of Lion in Winter was out. Mm-hmm. And we all loved the movie of mm-hmm. Lion in Winter. We all went around, you know, quoting bitchy dialogue to each other. And so we thought this would be really cool to do this kind of medieval thing where everybody was, like, very nasty to one another. And so we wrote this show. And then over the years, I won't bore you with the whole long story, somebody heard the score in New York and they were interested, and I began to work on it, and it sort of transmogrified from there into a semi-autobiographical piece about a young man in search of himself. And so the idea of a guy who's trying to look for what to do with his life kind of got grafted onto the story of Pippin, and it was sort of all accidental, but mm-hmm. that's what it made it interesting.
Mm-hmm. And then imposed on all of it was this incredible choreographic style.
Exactly.
Bob Fosse.
Yeah.
I mean,
the whole
with people
stage
like Anne
picture.
Reinking in the chorus.
Yeah.
At that time.
Oh yeah, it was an amazing.
It was
amazing
quite
chorus.
An amazing cast.
Yeah. Sandal Bergman was in the chorus, who went on to become Red Sonja and all
mm-hmm.
these people.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
And then of course you had Ben Vereen and Irene
exactly.
Ryan. What was Irene Ryan like?
Irene Ryan was great.
One of the last things she did. Wasn't it
was the last thing yeah. she did. There is
Remember
this
Irene
is this
Ryan
is a grisly joke. The grisly joke is that in because I think she was stricken on stage in Pippin, and in the men's chorus boys dressing room, somebody scrawled on the wall in the Imperial Theater, Stephen Schwartz killed Irene Ryan. That's
oh, no.
Like grisly joke, what can I tell you, but it's true. But she was
but
a wonderful woman. What?
Yeah, she was. That's the way to go out. She went out.
Absolutely.
She was remarkable.
Yeah. She had been an old vaudevillian before she did Granny in the Beverly Hillbillies. And Bob, I think it was Bob Fosse, remembered that she had done that, and he said, we should get her to do the show.
She was
such a wonderful woman. She was very supportive of young people. I think there's a scholarship mm-hmm. that still exists to this day
yeah.
for people aspiring to be in the theater that's named after her because she funded it.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Now, we're actually considering doing Pippin next year in
yes.
our season,
yes.
so let's host that. Now, The Magic Show was a unique experience because it really was framed around the magic of Doug Henning.
That's exactly right.
And it really exists in part and parcel with him, in a sense. I mean, the way
yeah,
the show was put
exactly.
together. Who came up with that idea?
What happened was that there was Edgar Lansbury and Joe Beru, who had produced Godspell, were in Canada. And they were, I think they were producing a tour of Gypsy at the time with Edgar's sister Angela Lansbury in it. And they called me and said, we've seen this kid magician mm-hmm. who's really unique. Mm-hmm. And we've never seen a magician like him, and he's really got a cool personality. And we know you like magic, and we think you'll kind of hit it off with him. Why don't you fly up and see him? So I flew up and I saw Doug do his act, and I thought it was amazing. But I said, you know, I really don't, this is me being stupid again. I said, I really don't want to spend 2 years. It was January, or it was late December. I said, I don't want to spend a whole year doing this. I will do it if we open this year. So they said, okay. And so there we said, go no. Now it takes me 12 years to do a musical. What? I don't know. Yeah, it went very well. The interesting thing about doing Magic Show was Doug, of course, didn't sing. And so the way we built the musical around him was that the illusions, the magic tricks, or I mean, he insisted on calling them illusions, were his musical numbers. And they actually advanced the plot. That's why it really can't be done without a mm-hmm. magician doing it mm-hmm. without the illusions, because part of the plot is sawing a woman in half,
right.
making a girl disappear, turning a woman into a leopard, and so on. It's built into the story the way in a musical songs give you character and give the plot. For Doug, those were his solos.
Mm-hmm.
And that exactly. was fun to construct it that way.
Yeah, yeah. And it's quite an entertaining show. It was fun to revisit it when we
Thanks.
Were looking
there's,
at it.
There's some talk about, I just actually got a call a couple of months ago, one of the people who puts together shows for Las Vegas, now that Las Vegas has become sort of family entertainment,
mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
has found a young magician.
Perfect.
Who sings.
Perfect. Well,
so
then
I'd have to write in some
songs.
So that would be fun to revisit
yeah.
it, I think.
Yeah. You know, when I was, I think I had just graduated high school when Godspell came into being, and I had always loved musical theater music, but of course I grew up with Rodgers and Hammerstein and Lerner and Lowe and Jerry Herman. And suddenly this voice came on the scene that seemed to be the voice of my generation. And when I first heard the songs from Pippin, I couldn't believe it. It was so fresh, and so it got under my skin so quickly, as well as Magic Show and Godspell. It was a unique and new voice in the sound of the musical theater. We're going to sing four songs for you now, two from Pippin and two from the Magic Show, and you'll see how innovative and yet so fresh and innocent the songs are. They're really quite remarkable. If Danny would come back out here, we're going to get started with, first of all, here's our Pippin. You remember that wonderful logo? And the Magic Show. We have our little albums here to go by. And we're going to introduce to you to sing the first song, our amazing young man who plays Cain in Children of Eden, Darius DeHaas.
Join us, come and waste an hour or two. Really do journey to a spot exciting, mystic and exotic. Journey through our anecdotic review. We've got magic to do just for you. We've got miracle praise to play. We've got parts to perform. hearts to warm. Kings and things to take by storm as we go along. Intrigue plots to bring disaster. Humor handled by a master. Romance, sex presented pastorally. So join us, sit where everybody can see. We got magic to do just for you. We've got miracle plays to play. We've got parts to perform, hearts to warm, kings and things to take by storm as we go along.
Have a whip but never use it. I'd
I never wanted fancy mansions, butlers and footmen livery. I never wanted lots of money. Money can't buy what you really need. I never wanted lots of money, but here I am on lobby knee. Please let me be a lion tamer. If I could be a lion tamer, wouldn't he have to?
I'd like Stephen to sing a song for us now. This is actually from an album which he's just put out, which is called Reluctant Pilgrim. But it has to do with magic. And it's quite a wonderful song. When I first heard it on this album, I fell in love with it, and I thought it was appropriate following our section about magic. And if Stephen would be so kind, I'd love him to sing it for us now with our lovely group here helping him out.
Thank you. cats. His room was full of screens and gypsy scars and dusty yellow magazines and old silk hats. I'd bring him cigarettes and share my wine and conversation. He paid me back with tricks a child could guess. He called them feats of prowess. Digitation. La 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 la. And then one night last fall, I came home late, and two men jumped me in the hall. They smelled of gin. One held me like a vice, one pulled a knife and giggled as he took a slice out of my chin. He pressed it to my throat, and I never knew such desperation. Just like a sinking ship that's in distress, with no one to SOS and no salvation. When all so suddenly we heard the roar of a beast with fur like ebony and razor claws. Dropped those men like stones, and the air was filled with the sound of screams and breaking bones in brutal jaws. And then it disappeared into the night of its creation, leaving behind a grim and bloody mess to please the most grotesque imagination. La 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 la. And why I'll never know, but right away I ran upstairs to Mario to tell my tale. He lay there on the bed, the room was dark, but I could see that he was dead. He looked so frail, and on his withered face there was a smile of such elation. Not even death could dim his happiness at one last great feat of prowess. Digitation. La 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 la.
Thank you, guys.
Thank you all.
Instant
Thank you.
Backup vocals.
They'll be back. Your songs paint such pictures, the images that they... We have a whole story before our eyes, and I'm curious now if we could take a few moments to talk about how you construct your songs, since mostly you do write words and music together.
Usually, yeah.
Are you inspired by the idea of the lyric first, and then you put music to it? Is there any formula, or is it really depending on the moment?
It does tend to come from the idea of the song first. I have this joke, because I teach sort of musical theater writing sometimes, and people say, well, how do you write a song? And my joke is, tell the truth and make it rhyme. You know? But it's kind of true. And whether you're writing a song that's about your own life, as frankly, pretty much all the songs on Reluctant Pilgrim, except for Prestidigitation, are. And even that was sort of inspired by this dream that I had, which I think was some memory of, I actually was mugged in New York City at knife point in the 70s, and I think that stayed with me, and then I woke up one day with this weird story in my head. But in any event, so it comes from the idea and the emotion of it, what the character is feeling, what the journey of the song is, what story you're trying to tell. Then often that will lead to a title, mm-hmm. and maybe a couple of lines, and then from there, that tends to lead to music. It leads to, I mean, Prestidigitation, which you just heard, started basically with, you know, that kind of, that riff.
And then, strange tale we're about to hear.
And then kind of the music happens more, pretty much first, and then I go back and fill in the words.
Well, that's interesting. Yeah.
And when I work with Alan Menken, as I did on some of the Disney things, which I know we're going to deal with later, or Charles Strauss on Rex, which I know we're going to hear some from later, all of that is music first. I mean, I'll come in with Charles, it was just playing music first. Mm-hmm. With Alan, sometimes I'll come in with a little bit of an idea, sometimes I'll come in with a title and four lines, but then we do music first, and then I do the lyric to that.
That's fascinating, and because your titles are so vivid. Just
Thanks.
The songs you've even just heard, Magic to Do, Corner of the Sky, Lion Tamer, West End Avenue, Prestidigitation. Those titles
Thanks.
Don't even resemble any other titles that I've ever heard. You know, how many songs are called West End Avenue or Prestidigitation? So there's this wonderful frame that the whole song hangs from.
Oh, thanks.
This brings us now you've had this triumphant success. You've had all of these successful musicals in a row, and then the movie of Godspell happens,
right?
Yeah. At the end of this period, or sort of as this period
so that
is
was
finishing.
Actually at the same time that the Pippin
time.
Was going on, so it was really... Yeah.
And it was quite wonderful because it was filmed all over New York City.
It was, yeah. There they are on top of the World Trade Center before it was finished.
Before it was finished, yeah.
We went up on top of the World Trade Center for this thing, and it was not finished, and there were no railings.
Oh, my God.
And we stood up there, and
there
it was
are no railings
really,
in this picture.
It was a really windy day.
Whoa.
And those... I don't think they let people up on top of the Twin Towers anymore, and the buildings are going like this. You know, and everybody's standing up there. Look, they have to dance and everything.
I know, and
they're
right
like,
near the
oh
edge.
My God,
right
oh my God.
Yeah. This isn't like computer superimposed
no.
in those days, you
yeah,
know.
Yeah, no, that was it.
That's
it was
incredible.
A little scary, but it was, you know, exciting.
How exciting.
Anything for art.
Yeah. How exciting. All right, so this all happens. Mm-hmm. You have this phenomenal success. And I think now, at this point, had you also gotten married? And
yeah,
was your,
yeah, yeah, yeah.
Was your son born yet?
He was born right around the time of Magic Show.
Right around the time of Magic Show.
Yeah, yeah.
Okay, and we'll talk a little bit more about him in a little while.
Right.
All right, so now we enter sort of a new phase, another phase.
Yeah, a bad phase.
Yeah, all right. Well, I'm glad you said it.
A dark phase. No, it wasn't bad, but it was challenging.
How
a challenging
long was
phase.
It before you wrote The Baker's Wife?
Baker's Wife was 76, and that was a really problematic show, very difficult out-of-town tryout, a lot of extremely volatile personalities, and it was one of those sort of legend. You know the joke about wishing on your worst enemy that he'd be out of town with the musical in trouble.
That was it.
Yeah. Oh man, it was tough. Yeah.
It starred Paul Sorvino and Patti LuPone.
Eventually.
Didn't start with them.
Oh no, everybody was fired along the way. Yeah. I kept trying to get fired.
And you couldn't
manage
it.
No, they wouldn't. They made me stay to the
bitter
end.
Well, the phenomenon about The Baker's Wife, and it eventually became a CD after all was said and done. You got this CD produced.
Yeah, what happened?
The record produced.
Well, what happened was this was in the days when they didn't record flop shows.
Mm-hmm.
And the show closed out of town. It was just an unmitigated flop. And then these two really strange people came to me, the Yekos, Bruce and Doris Yekko, and they said, we saw the show, and we really love the music, and we want to record it, and we'll finance a recording. But we can only do the solo numbers. We can't do the chorus numbers because we can't pay the chorus. And by God, they did. You know, we
well,
went to a studio.
Well, I have to
it.
Tell you, if you've never heard the CD of The Baker's Wife, I believe this is right up there in my top five favorite musical recordings that I've ever heard. It is so beautiful. Paul Sorvino, Patti LuPone, Kurt Peterson, the voices are wonderful. But beyond that, this CD all by itself tells the whole story. You get the whole emotional story of this lovely, charming little fable. It's very, very, very beautiful music, beautifully, beautifully orchestrated.
Thanks.
And we're going to sing some songs for you from Baker's Wife. It's the kind of, and we will, when we finish that, we'll tell you it was revived recently in London. So the journey continues with this particular show.
Oh, yeah,
show.
No, things are.
But I'd love you to hear some of the songs first before we talk a little more about it. And Stephen's going to start us off with the opening song.
Great.
From Baker's
I'm going to take
Wife.
A glug of water real quick.
A little bit of water.
Trying not to feed back the mic.
Really, though, if you're a collector of these and you don't have this is a rare and beautiful, beautiful treat. So this is the first
it's the
song.
Number. It's called
from
Chanson.
Chaque jour est un jour comme les autres du jour. Le potage, l'ouvrage, peut-être l'amour. Le soleil, il voyage, le monde fait un tour. Ainsi c'est toujours le même. Every day as you do what you do every day, you see the same faces who fill the cafe. And if some of those faces have new things to say, nothing is really different. And the wind changes course, and the moon changes phase, and the world spins around with the greens and the grays, and you never take time out to think of the ways. Everything might be different. And then one day, suddenly, something can happen. It may be quite simple, it may be quite small, but all of a sudden, your stew tastes different, and you hear a gull cry in a different key, and you see with new eyes, and the faces you see are people you don't know at all. And the someone who touches your hair every day touches you now in a different way. And you may want to run, or you may want to stay forever. And since life is the cry of the gull, and the taste of your stew, and the way that you feel when she touches you, now your whole life is different. Now your whole life is new. La 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 la. Chaque jour est un jour comme les autres du jour. Le potage, l'ouvrage, peut-être l'amour. Le soleil, il voyage, le monde fait un tour. Ainsi c'est toujours le même.
Let Danny get in. Come up here and help me set the stage. So we would like to introduce our three main characters for The Baker's Wife.
So as you can gather from the from that song, it's quite a simple story, and the idea of the show is what happens to this tiny remote French village in Provence when this simple triangle occurs. We have the baker, who has just come to a town that has been without bread for 6 weeks, which in France is a calamity. Our older baker, and his beautiful young wife, who is so beautiful and so young that at first they mistake her for his daughter. And of course, as you may imagine, eventually this becomes a triangle when a handsome young man in the village, who is the marquis's handyman, sets his cap for the wife.
Isn't it a crime? Isn't it a crying shame that the love of my life should have to be another man's wife? Well, I finally found the one true love of my life. She splits my senses at the seams. She sends a shiver up my spine. I see her body in my dreams. And if she's normal, she sees mine. She's all I'm ever thinking of, her mouth, her hair, and all the rest. I think all women should have love, and one like her should have the best. There is no rule of law in heaven or on earth. There is no way to stop this fire once it starts. In lips and hands and hearts and other moving parts. And I'm singing your face, you'll come into my arms, and love will flow like wine. What is the way to turn her head? What do I say? What do I wear? My belt is tight, my shirt is red, and open just enough to show a little hair. No other girl I've ever known has looked this hot and kept this cool. I know she can't be made of stone, I know she can't be such a fool. No matter what the pain, no matter what the price, no matter what, I wouldn't stop it if I could. How can a thing be bad when it feels so good? And I'm singing, oh, proud lady, you and I both know, yes, you will be mine. And we'll go to that spot where the grass is cool and shady, and like it or not, you're coming to my arms, and love will flow like wine. I'm in love again, I'm in love, and isn't it a crime, isn't it a crying shame that the love of my life should have to be another man's wife? Well, I'm sorry for the guy, but there's nothing I won't try to win the one true love of my life.
Favorite story of the meadowlark who lived with the river's wine. Her voice could match the angels in its glory, but she was blind. The lark was blind. An old king came and took her to his palace. where the walls were burnished bronze and golden braid. And he fed her fruit and nuts from an ivory chalice, and he prayed, "Sing for me, my meadowlark, sing for me on the silver morning, set me free. Brocade and cruel, and I'll love you for life if you will sing for me." And one day, as the lark sang by the water, the god of the sun heard her in his flight, and her singing moved him, so he came and brought her the gift of sight. He gave her sight, she opened her eyes to the shimmer and the splendor of this beautiful young god, so proud and strong. And he called to the lark in a voice both rough and tender, "Come along, fly with me, my meadowlark, fly with me on the silver morning. On the coral beaches, make a feast of the plums and peaches, just as far as your vision reaches. Fly with me." But the meadowlark said no, for the old king loved her so, she couldn't bear to wound his bride. So the sun god flew away, and when the king came down that day, meadowlark had died. Every time I heard that part, I cried. And now I stand here, starry-eyed and stormy, just when I thought my heart was finally numb, a beautiful young man appears before me, singing, "Come, has come at last, it's picked the worst time. Still I know I've got to go. Fly away, meadowlark, fly away on the silver morning. If I stay, I'll grow to curse the dark. So it's off where the days won't bind me. I know I leave wounds behind me, but I won't let tomorrow find me back this way. Before my past once again can blind me, fly away.
been gone. The light stayed dim and the shutters drawn. But the clock keeps running and time runs on, and there's time enough has flown. If I have to live alone, the leaves still rustle, the wind still whines, the sun shines colder, but still it shines. I do my living between the lines, like the silent times I've known, when I had to live. I had my ways to fill the hours, to kill the days, have a meal at the cafe. Every night at 10, take a walk, take a nap, perhaps a card game now and then. I've lived alone before, and I can do it again. I still hear laughter, I still see stars, and if it's true that a smile comes hard, well, that's the reason that God made scars, to protect us once they've grown. Let them harden now like stone. Let them harden now like stone. If I have to live alone.
Kelly, Bart, come out. Come take a bow. All three of you, come back out here. Aren't they wonderful? And Danny, thank you. You're incredible. Danny. Stephen, come on up here. Stay. That music, those are just three and four of the most beautiful songs on this album. They're all incredible. It's a beautiful, beautiful score. It's one of the great tragedies of musical theater, that this isn't the big hit it should be.
Well, it's still around. People do it.
It's got to be done. Right. And especially with wonderful performers like this, it will happen.
Well, it helps when you have really great performers.
So after Baker's Wife, you embark on another interesting and and troubled, ultimately, project, Working.
Well, actually, it was troubled incipiently, I guess, whatever the opposite of ultimately would be, which was the adaptation of Studs Terkel's nonfiction book of interviews, Working, with people about their jobs. And this was something that I adapted and directed. And originally, I was going to do the score, and then when I really got into thinking about it, I thought, well, all these characters are so different, and it's a documentary. Mm-hmm. And for me to write all the songs, a great deal of what I would have to do would be pastiche. Mm-hmm. Because, you know, I mean, I would have to imitate other styles and other kinds of writers, and I thought, well, why don't I just get other writers?
So because it's all about different occupations.
Exactly.
And different
exactly. And a parking lot attendant, a mill worker, which for which James Taylor wrote just a fantastic song, and a parking lot attendant that Mickey Grant wrote wonderful, and so on and so forth. So I put all these people together. We developed the show over a period of time. It came into New York. I won't cast aspersions about why things didn't go so well in New York, but we had some difficulties there, and it was not successful on Broadway. But then quite a wonderful thing happened, and happened fairly quickly thereafter, which was that people were very intense about the show and wanted to keep doing it. And it, so I worked on it for a few productions afterwards, put some cuts in because it was way too long on Broadway, which was principally the problem with it. And put some cuts in and moved little things around a bit, but mostly just put cuts in. And then an organization for which Dan Kosarin works, which is called Music Theater International, picked the show up and started licensing it for all these productions, and it became just this gigantic stock and amateur and regional theater hit. You know, went on and on and on for 20 years. And now, recently, it's just been, had a new production down in Washington at a theater called the Signature Theater, for which we had to update the show because it's now 20 years later mm-hmm. and mm-hmm. the jobs have changed.
Yeah, exactly.
So I had to call, I called Studs Terkel and said, could I use material from some of your more recent books? And we did some new interviews, et cetera. And this is the first time doing the updated version. It's gone very well. So I think the updated version will now be out there. And everybody who did it before can do it again.
Can do it again.
Oh, there you go.
Well, we'd like to give you a taste of two of the most delightful songs from working. These are songs that Stephen wrote.
Yeah, I did four of the songs.
He did four of the songs in the show, and these are two of them. The first song is going to be sung by a young man who is the youngest man in our cast of Children of Eden, and his name is Paul Iocono, and you will soon find out what his vocation is when he sings his song for you. Go ahead.
Even that bar men. For them, it's a tip. See, for me, I'm a gypsy. Just toss me a coin, and I suddenly feel like I'm Carmen. So on through the ulcers, the backaches, the hot, sweaty feet. On you go. Through, is your knife dull, sir? And madam wants what with her meat? On you go. 2 a.m. approaches, the curtains descend. There among the roaches, my act's at an end. Every night I tend to find myself crying. There's no work so trying or so satisfying. I tell everybody that I'm a waitress and I'm proud. Somebody comes up to me and says, hey, you're terrific. How come you're just a waitress? You know what I say to them?
Great song.
Thank you.
So now we finish the trilogy of the...
The trilogy of flops.
No,
but they've all come back, It's okay.
And this one is really an incredibly beautiful score again, Rags. Can you tell us about how the idea came up for the show and how it worked?
Yeah, Rags originated with Joseph Stein, who also wrote the book for Baker's Wife and had written the book for Fiddler on the Roof and was interested in the idea of what happened to people like the characters in Fiddler on the Roof after they came to America. So it was a story about immigrants in America around the time of 1910 and followed several mostly Jewish immigrants and what happened with them. There's a character, the principal character is a woman named Rebecca who comes over with her young son and to meet her husband, and when she gets there, her husband isn't there. And so she's thrown back on her own devices, and it's kind of what she goes through. And then she's befriended by a young girl named Bella, who's been brought over there kind of against her will by her father. And then when she gets there, she's working in a sweatshop all the time and isn't very happy about her life in America. And it's basically about those two women and the relationship between the two of them.
Well, let's hear, we're going to hear
Oh, you know
songs.
What we need to say?
Yes.
It's music by Charles Strauss.
Charles Strauss.
It's not my music. My
music.
Lyrics, Charles Strauss
Stephen
is
wrote the lyrics.
Wonderful music.
And here are three songs from Rags.
What's that music playing down there on the street? On that push cart, is that a thing you could eat? That one, why is he yelling so loud at the fat one? What a crowd they got. See that lady, what has she got on her head? No more hats here, it's feathers and fruit. Instead, so many noises, colors, mixed up and swirled into a brand new world here. Here we are in a brand. David, it belongs to you.
Children of the wind.
meant we've been there for a lifetime, and I'll know then they will never be.
Wonderful, wonderful things about them, but they weren't successful.
That's
so how did you feel at the end of this period of your life now?
Well, it was difficult. but, you know, what doesn't kill us makes us stronger, right? Isn't that the saying? So I think, you know, it was a time for growing up and a time for learning that all the lights aren't always going to turn green and so on. What's been incredibly lucky for me and what I feel very grateful for is that all three shows continued to live. You know, so often when you have a show that doesn't work in its first commercial production, that's the end of it, and you never hear from it again. And Baker's Wife, and particularly Working, but also Rags, go, you know, on into other productions, and you know, kind of have happy afterlives. So you know, that's a lucky ending for me.
But did you feel disenchanted with Broadway? I mean, because it was part of it, well, the process. How did Broadway change to you over those years? Was the way things were done different, or was it just the circumstances?
I was pretty disenchanted with Broadway from the get-go. Mm-hmm. Because Pippin was such a difficult experience for me. It really wasn't an issue of whether things were hits or flops, but just that I found the working circumstances so unpleasant. And finally, I just thought, I can't do this anymore. It's no fun. And it seemed to me to be all about ego and power and money, and it was really hard to do your work. So that's why I haven't been back to Broadway. That's why I'm here, where I have a wonderful time, you know, and I get a wonderful show to boot. Yeah. So
you took a little side trip.
I did. So I went west. You know, as Horace Greeley told me to do.
Yes, yes. Yeah. And again, very successfully, new boy in town.
Yeah, that worked out.
How
flavor
did this
of the
happen?
Month.
Your first big project there was Pocahontas with Disney.
Right.
And you worked with Alan Menken. How did that all come about?
Well, what happened was two things happened. First of all, Alan with his partner, Howard Ashman, who also was so disenchanted with Broadway that he left, reinvented the animated musical, because Howard wanted to write musicals and he didn't want to write them on Broadway, and he had the chance to work for Disney. And so in The Little Mermaid, they basically, and then Beauty and the Beast, they reinvented the animated musical. And at this time Disney began to think, maybe other people who've written for the musical theater could do the same thing for us. So they called me and I had a meeting with them. And then of course a thing that was very, very tragic happened, which was that Howard Ashman, who was one of the most gifted contributors to the musical theater, both as animation and in theater, died of AIDS. And at that point, Disney was looking for another partner for Alan, and they asked me if I would want to do it, and you know, just write lyrics. And I knew Alan; we were friends, and we lived very near one another. And you know, I was very thrilled for the opportunity, and so that's how that came about.
Mm-hmm. And very successfully, because you didn't bring it. I wanted you to bring your little Oscar to show everybody, or your big Oscar. How heavy is it?
They're pretty heavy.
They're
pretty heavy. The boys, we call them. They live at home, and
yes,
on either side of the.
For the score and for one song in particular.
For the song, Colors of the Wind. See, it was so interesting because Therese just saying, Children of the Wind and others, Colors of the Wind, and I promised Disney that I would stop writing of songs. Because a corner of the sky, I was like, okay, I'm not writing any blank of the blank anymore, I promise.
This Spark is the last of one. Creation.
Well, Children of Eden is all of songs. Okay, all right. That's kind of an in-joke. It's all of songs.
But before we sing that beautiful song that won you your Oscar, then fast on the heels of the success of Pocahontas, you began working on Hunchback.
Well, what happened was, Alan, that was a professional marriage that just worked from the get-go. Colors of the Wind was, in fact, the first song that we wrote together and the first song that was written for Pocahontas, and Disney was very excited about it. And so after about, once we were kind of well underway in Pocahontas, they asked us to do the next one as well. And that was Hunchback of Notre Dame, which is one of my, I just love the movie. It was
it's
one of
beautiful.
My
it's
favorite
so
projects that I've ever done. And now we're sort of working on it for the stage as well.
That's
so
great.
That's exciting.
I'm curious, when you write the songs, do you really spell out for the animators how you see the sequence? Because there are several sequences, like the song Out There, which we're going to sing, which is totally framed with all of these wonderful journeys through the Cathedral of Notre Dame and bursting forth into the world of Paris.
No, the animators actually do it, and that's one of the things that makes it so much fun to do animation, because the animators, the songs obviously get written first, and then they take the lyrics and they cut them up into little strips and they put them on big bulletin boards and they draw all these storyboards, and you go in and see these amazing things that the artists have come up with.
And then is that the inspiration for the songs?
No, it's the other way. We do the songs, and then they put it. Occasionally,
but you indicate things, ideas for them of how a journey could happen. Or, for instance, when you wrote the song for Esmeralda in the church, and it's framed against the stained glass windows and all of those things.
They do it.
They just do it.
They do it. I mean, we come in and talk about. Oh, they're so amazing. They're
really beautiful.
The storyboard artists at Disney and actually now at DreamWorks too are astoundingly gifted people.
Now, the thing that I was very nervous about Hunchback was the fact that it has a happy ending, being that I love to adapt these novels and everything, and thinking, oh my, but you know, the Hunchback dies. Then when I saw it, it worked so successfully because the message of the book still comes through so clearly, and you're so moved by the experience. But was that ever, how are we really going to end this? Can we afford to end with the death of the Hunchback, or do we have to do this, or how did that...
Disney got such a hard time for not killing Quasimodo off at the end of the movie, but the fact is that there have been several other very successful screen adaptations, most notably the Charles Laughton one, which I think won a Best Picture Oscar. He's just hale and hearty right at the end. I mean, he don't die in that, and, you know, no one seemed to get too angry about that. You know, people always take swipes at
Disney. But I just know that it was always... It was this bone of contention.
Yeah, it was, but there was really never a question about were we going to kill off Quasimodo at the end of the movie. Obviously, what we did for Disney was to take the story and try to stay true to Victor Hugo's basic concept, but it became, in a way, as the Disney animated features are, something which has a message for young people, and it became a story about a young man, Quasimodo, who learns under the most difficult circumstances to feel okay about himself, you know, and we're all a little bit Quasimodo inside.
I think so.
So that was basically the message of that.
Well, we're going to sing two songs. First, Colors of the Wind by Angela Garrison will be out here to sing that, and then a song from Hunchback. Here we are.
Have you ever heard the wolf cry to the blue-born moon, or ask the grinning bobcat why? run the hidden pine trails of the forest. Come taste the sun-sweet berries of the earth. Come roll in all the riches all around you. And for once, never wonder what there were. The rainstorm and the river are my brothers. The heron and the otter are my friends. In a hoop that never ends. Have you ever heard the wolf cry to the blue-born moon? Or let the eagle tell you where he's been? Can you sing with all the voices of the mountain? Can you paint with all the colors of the wind? Can you paint with all the colors of the wind?
I am your only friend. I who keep you, teach you, feed you, dress you. I who look upon you without fear. How can I protect you, boy, unless you always stay in here, away in here? Remember what I taught you, Quasimodo. You are deformed.
I am deformed.
And you are ugly.
And I am ugly.
In this old crime for which the world shows little pity, you do not comprehend.
You are my one defender.
Out there they will hate you like a monster.
I am a monster.
Out there they will hate and scorn and jeer.
Only a monster.
Why invite the calumny and consternation? Stay in here, be faithful to
me. I'm faithful.
Grateful.
I'm grateful.
Do as I say.
I'll stay.
How it feels to spend the day not above them.
them. Every day they shout and scold and go about their lives, heedless of the gift it is to be them. If I was in their skin, I'd treasure every instant out there, strolling by the stem. Taste a morning out there, like ordinary men who freely walk about there. There they all live unaware, won't resent, don't despair. Old and bent, I won't care, won't resent, won't despair.
I messed up on the lyrics.
Oh. I always forget the words to everything.
Your lyrics are so wonderful to sing, even when I remember them. I forgot one, but they're great to, they just come so naturally. I mean, they really flow off the tongue. I mean, how did you just always do that, or was it a conscious decision to make this conversation work?
Yeah, I mean, I started writing lyrics in college, basically, out of self-defense, because I just felt that the people I was working with didn't really express what it was that I was trying to say in the song. And you know, lyrics are a craft. It's like becoming a potter, you know. You have to work at it and work at it and work at it, and after a while you learn how to do it. I do think it helps, though it's more difficult, to work music first, because then the lyrics can kind of lay on the music you have a chance to adjust the lyrics so they flow at the same speed at which the music is going, and when the music goes up, the lyric goes up, and so on and so forth. It's kind of a lesson I learned way back when I did the Bernstein Mass, where a couple of the things I did lyrics first, and Lenny set them to music, and he went a different way than I expected the music to go, and I didn't know well enough then to just chuck what I'd done originally and go back and rewrite the lyric to fit the music. And therefore, I think there are some things that have beautiful music, but lyrically are awkward, and I just, you know, I just was young and I didn't know any better. But now, you know, I know to even if there's a bit of a lyric that I've done, and then let's say Alan sets it musically, then often I'll just throw out what I did and go back and try and get the lyric to just go exactly with the music, ebb and flow with the music, and as I say this, let the speed of the words be the same as the speed of the music. And you know, I take it as a great compliment what you said. It should be easy to sing. It should be like conversation. It should be an acted scene, and that's all it should be.
Well, that brings us to this beautiful song. It's another song that's on your album, The Reluctant Pilgrim, and I heard you sing it in New York at a special benefit one night. It's called Life Goes On.
Right.
The lyrics tell a very moving and beautiful and poetic story.
Thanks.
I don't know if there's anything you'd like to tell us about the inspiration for the song before you sing it, but it's a really special song that I'd love for all of you to hear.
Thank you. Well, it was the first song that I wrote before I even knew I was going to do a CD of personal songs. It was when I began writing songs where I wasn't hiding behind hunchbacks and Indian princesses, but you know, just coming right out and kind of writing about myself and my life and my relationships and the people that I knew. And as I began to do that, this was one incident. This was really a song I had to write because I was so haunted by, I didn't know how else really to deal with my emotions about something that had happened. And I really think it's self-explanatory. I think when you hear it, you'll understand why.
Oh.
Mm-hmm.
I drove over the white stone bridge. It was a beautiful day for a ride, one of those glorious mornings in May. The sun on the bay, sparkling like diamonds. I drove up to the white stone building. I saw your mother and father outside, those dysfunctional people I used to despise. Now the tears in their eyes glittered like diamonds, while my eyes were dry. You were not a part of my life, really. I was not a part of your life very much. Our roads went separate ways, and occasional days they would touch. So why should it seem strange? Nothing much should change now that you are gone. You were not a part of my life, and life goes on. Life goes on. There was a picture of you on an easel, looking just like you did on TV. Impossibly handsome, too tanned to be true. And your eyes were so blue and clearer than diamonds. There were no bruises or tubes in your chest. There were no patches of skull in your hair, no hollow stare and no skeleton grin. The bones through your skin, brittle as diamonds, as you struggled for air. But you were not a part of my life, really. So I tell myself this numbness I feel isn't bad. Every day so many fall, if we grieved for them all, we'd go mad. So it's best to keep controlled, just a little cold, just a bit withdrawn. You're no longer part of this life, and life goes on. And we trooped out to the pretty little grave when the speeches were done. And we all mumbled some pretty little prayer beneath the warm, indifferent sun. And I wanted some callous politician or some cruel god I could blame. It's all so unfair. I drove back over the white stone bridge. We had some friends dropping by for a meal, and soon I was laughing and eating my Franks, watching the Yanks stink up the diamond. But as the days and the weeks have gone by, I am amazed at how haunted I feel. Seems with this dry-eyed detachment I choose, there's something I lose, like a counterfeit diamond that used to be real. And somewhere there's a part of my life missing. Somewhere there's a piece of my heart that you kept. I know more will die just like you, and what else can we do but accept? Still I sing this song just to say it feels all wrong knowing you are gone. And a slightly smaller part of my life. Goes on.
Stay here. Oh, right.
Well, this brings us to the most important part of the evening, the reason we're all here, Children of Eden.
Yes.
You did the New Testament, and then now here in this big arc all the way at the other side, here we are with the Old Testament.
Right.
What is it about the Bible?
That's a good question. Because none of the shows really are about the Bible. They're not really, I mean, not Godspell, not Children of Eden, not Prince of Egypt, which is the animated feature of the Moses story that I'm doing the score for DreamWorks. It's that they're great stories, they're very dramatic stories, and they're well-known stories. And therefore, whatever point of view you take about this story reverberates, because people say, wait a minute, he's going a different way with this. What point is he making? And obviously, for those who've seen Children of Eden, and if you haven't, you need to see this man's brilliant production. It's just unbelievable. But anyway, for those of you who've seen it, it's about families and about how the mistakes and difficulties of one generation get passed on along to the next, to the next, to the next, until finally somebody breaks the chain and says, no, I'm not going to make these mistakes anymore, I'm not going to do this anymore. And then they can be healed, and then the family can be healed. So it's about parents and children, which is one of my favorite themes.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. Now, this, though, had a very unusual journey to get to this spot, even to get to your theme, to decide what you wanted it to be about.
Right. Well, it began basically as an oratorio. A friend of mine who was a designer for Radio City Music Hall, who did the Christmas show and the Easter show there, had this idea. He wanted to do another kind of show that could be done in the summer, and he had the idea to do the Book of Genesis. And he came to me and he said, I want to do something that begins at the creation and ends right after the flood. And I thought, second chances, something about second chances. And then at the same time, I'd been offered a commission for a church in St. Louis that brought together high school kids every 2 years and did an original work with them. And so I did this sort of 11-song oratorio, which went very well. And indeed, many of the songs that were in it are still in some form in the show today. But when we saw it, then it became clear that what it was really about. And that's when the journey of writing the show was embarked upon, and John Caird came in as the writer, and it's been a long journey, but obviously it's had a very happy ending. Mm-hmm. So
it did have a London production.
Did have a London production.
But that was complicated because of the circumstances.
Well, it was really weird. I mean, it was premature to do the London production, because we were originally going to do a workshop with the RSC, the way John Caird had developed Nicholas Nickleby and Les Miserables, and then the RSC lost their funding because of arts cutbacks. It was interesting. I heard you talking about that.
Mm-hmm. And remember
tonight.
Those art cutbacks,
yes.
Those little envelopes you have, don't
right.
forget.
And so then the decision was made to try and do the show directly for the West End, and we really weren't ready for it. And then sometimes in London you can open a show in the West End and kind of continue to tinker with it, but what happened in this case was that the day after we opened, the Gulf War broke out, which was an unfortunate circumstance because people were really heading out to the theater, trying to duck the Scud missiles that they thought might be heading their ways.
But unfortunate and fortunate as all turns out.
Well, it worked out. You know, certainly has had a very happy ending that we've wound up here with what I think is...
Because you continued then after you had what you had there. And
right.
Actually, even the role of the father had sort of just come into it at the point...
At the very... Yeah, he had just entered.
You hadn't even put him into the play, as it were.
That's correct. I mean, when we began the show, actually when we were casting for London, the role of the father, which is obviously a very central role, and is sort of the character who grows and changes throughout the piece, he was the sound of thunder.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and after a while, John and I said, well, we really need him in this scene, and we really need him to be there, and so gradually he started showing up, and then actually it was after London, we were like,
duh. He's the central character. So but it took a while to find shows, and particularly musicals, I think, take a while to find what they're about. And they have to go through a very long, it's like birthing an elephant or something. It's a really long gestation period.
Yeah, especially in this case, unlike Godspell.
Well, but, you know, someone has to do the work. Don't forget that John Michael had conceived it, had done it at Carnegie Mellon, had, I think he did it twice at Carnegie Mellon, and then they did it at Café La Mama. So by the time I came into it, they were three productions in. It was, you know, not hard for me to look at what was on the stage at Café La Mama and say, like, oh, I get what they're trying to do, because someone had already done all that legwork.
We'd like to bring out our leading man, if we may, Mr. Adrian Zmed. There's a song in the show, which is the only song from Children of Eden which is recorded, which is on Stephen's album right. Reluctant Pilgrim. Unfortunately, there isn't a recording of Children of Eden
yet.
But we're working on that.
We are.
But this song is very special, and there's a reason why you put it on this album. There's a reason why you're singing it, and I'd like you both to tell everybody about your experience with this song.
I know. You want to go first?
Oh. Parents. I have an 11-year-old son and a 15-year-old son, and I'll tell you a quick little story here. I was just home a couple of weeks ago, and I was out to dinner with my oldest and my youngest. My oldest says to me, and this is after putting together a college fund for him and working so hard and trying to make sure he has good grades in school, and he says to me, you know, Dad, I think after high school I'm thinking of taking a couple of years off. This song, when I first heard it, I had known about this project for a few years from Stephen, and I had heard the music was really quite wonderful and beautiful and special, and I just heard one song when they had asked me to do this, and when I heard the words in this song and the melody, I said, I have to do this. It's every parent's words. It truly comes from my heart. Absolutely everything in this song is so special, and it's so true, and it's about becoming a parent and learning how to become a parent. This entire show is about the journey of a parent. When we get our first child in this world, we don't know what to do with it, and if it wasn't for our parents, we wouldn't know how to handle this thing that comes into our world. And this is a show about God learning how to be a parent, about Adam and Eve learning how to be parents, and then Noah and Mama Noah 1,000 years later. And we go through the phases, and this phase right here is the most important phase, and that is learning that you have to let go at a certain point and let your children fly on their own.
Did you write this really out of your personal relationship with your own son?
It was written for the show, but the reason I put it on the album is because it's such a personal song. Like Adrian, I had, at the time when I wrote the song, I had two teenagers, and I had the joy of experiencing a teenage daughter, which is a difficult difficult phase. Though she, they come out the other end. For those of you who have teenage daughters, it's okay eventually, but it's tough. This song, it was easy to write this song. Let me say that it was really easy to get in touch with what this song was about. But I think Adrian has sort of said. Better, frankly, more eloquently than I was going to, what I have to say about it. So,
I think the song says it most eloquently of all. So, would you sing it for us?
So, we'll do we have a little duet we've cooked up for you tonight.
This is actually God and Noah singing the song.
Oh, this son of mine I love so well, and oh, the toll it takes. I would build a bridge of dreams for him and patch it where it breaks. But the one thing he most treasures is to make his own mistakes. Oh, he is bound for lands I've traveled. I remember them so clear. I could tell him what to watch for. I could warn him what to fear. I could shout until I'm breathless, and he'd still refuse to hear. Oh, but you cannot close the acorn once the oak begins to grow. And you cannot close your heart to what it fears and needs to know. That the hardest part of love is the letting go.
As a child, I found a sparrow that had fallen from its nest, and I nursed it back to health till it was stronger than the rest. And when I tried to hold it, then it pecked and scratched my chest till I let it go. And I watched it fly away from me with its bright and selfish song. And part of me was cursing I had helped it grow so strong. And I feared it might go hungry, and I feared it might go wrong, oh. But I could not close the acorn once the oak began to grow. And I cannot close my heart to what it fears and needs to know. That the hardest part of love
is the letting go, is the letting go. And it's only in Eden grows a rose without a thorn. And your children start to leave you on the day that they are born. They will leave you there to cheer for them. They will leave you there to mourn ever so.
Like an ark on uncharted seas, their lives will be tossed. And the deeper is your love for them, the crueler is the cost. And just when they start to find themselves is when you fear they're lost, oh.
But you cannot close the acorn once the oak begins to grow. And you cannot close your heart to what it fears and needs to know.
That the hardest part of love
and the rarest part of love
and the truest part of
love is letting go.
Stephen, come out here.
Come out here.
We're coming toward the end of our evening. And as you see, we have our cast members here from Children of Eden and all of our wonderful singers tonight. They've all come back out here to sing a final song for you. Thank you all for being a part of this and performing so beautifully. And Stephen, we have a thank you for you from the cast. Everybody signed a little something in here for you. And we want to thank you not only for writing this incredibly beautiful show for us, but inspiring us for all of these years with your beautiful and touching lyrics and your beautiful melodies. Thank you.
Thank you. Should I open it or just do it? Ooh. Oh my gosh, how beautiful.
It's a little
it's
Noah's,
our pal Noah.
Noah's Ark.
Oh, can I take it out? Oh, look. Oh, it's all signed. Oh, fabulous.
There it is. See that?
Oh, that's so beautiful. Thank you.
But there are more animals on stage than are on this.
God knows.
You get to see them doing
yeah,
this.
Yeah. I didn't want to break it. Oh, that's beautiful. Thank you very,
Stephen
very much.
Stephen is going to be out in the lobby after the show. If you'd like to speak to him, ask him any questions. If you'd like to.
I'll sign records if you'll buy records.
He'll do whatever you like. He's going to go out there now so we can meet you, but I want you to stay and hear this beautiful finale. I think it is one of the most beautiful songs ever written for the musical theater. I cry every night when I sit in the audience. I can never grow tired of this beautiful, beautiful song. Stephanie's going to lead us in Children of Eden.
Okay.
And Stephen,
do I go
you
this
go
way?
That way, and everyone will see you afterwards. Stay well. Thank you, Stephen.
Don't work, and and second chances. Children of Eden, where have we left you? Born to uncertainty, destined for pain. Sins of your parents haunt you and test you. This, your inheritance, fire and rain. Children of Eden, try not to blame us. We were just human to error prone. Children of Eden, will you reclaim us, you and your children to come someday, to come
home?
Thank you.